Hello and welcome to Marxism Today. My name is Red Wagner, and I am joined by...
Tony Schmidt.
And...
Thad Logan.
And today, we did something a little bit different. We watched a movie, a piece of culture, if you will, and we will be doing some critique about that. And actually, Tony selected the movie. Tony, do you want to tell us a little bit about what the movie was and why you selected it?
Please do.
Yeah, so I thought it would be good for us to watch the DreamWorks animated film B-Movie with Jerry Seinfeld, where he is a bee.
B-E-E movie.
Yeah, B-E-E. And I wanted to watch this movie because it comes off to me as a pretty strong piece of capitalist propaganda. I think we'll have to discuss if, I don't know, I might be the only one who reads it that way. But the movie, I guess to give a brief summary, if you haven't seen it, if you're lucky you haven't, I guess it wasn't that terrible. It's kind of, it's really weird.
There are some very surreal parts that are pretty fun. Yeah.
So Jerry Seinfeld is Barry the Bee, because it of course has to be a bee name, mm-hmm. I guess. He is a bee freshly graduated from college and going into the transition between being a bee and, or being, you know, like educated and then going into the workforce. And it's him sort of not knowing what he wants to do, not really wanting to do that, wanting to do something else, and flying off and finding a human who they're not supposed to talk to for reasons that are never actually specified.
Xenophobia.
Oh, yeah. Xenophobia. Yep. Yeah, we'll have to get into the racism in this movie.
The movie is very into xenophobia.
Anyway, talks with the human, realizes that humans are taking the bee's honey. And this is where I think it's kind of an interesting thing, is the movie starts out very much talking about, pointing out things of, you know, the oppressed conditions of the workers and the humans appropriating the product of the labor of the bees.
And the bees are on board.
Yeah.
I mean, they are naturalized beyond compare. They love it.
Yeah, yeah. And except Barry.
Yep.
And so Barry sues the human race somehow, inexplicably. Ah, they ignore appeals, too. That's weird. So he sues, he sues the human race.
Sequel.
Yeah, exactly. The appeal. He sues the human race and wins for, I don't know, it's not important how. It's kind of silly.
Right.
And then, so the bees get all their honey, and then this is where I think there's a big turn in the movie, because it goes from being very pro-worker and pro, let's take back, you know, let's expropriate what's expropriated from us sort of thing.
Bane switch here, for sure.
And then it goes to, now the bees have all the honey, and they're lazy, and literally everything on Earth is going to die, because now the bees have all the product of their labor.
They're not pollinating flowers, so everything starts to die. Trees start, businesses start to fail. They're implying that agriculture is going to fail as well.
Yeah. Even the wind-pollinated plants fail, just out of solidarity with their fellow plant life.
There's nothing.
Yeah. So then he realizes that really, I guess, in my reading, is that, you know, that this collective reappropriation of the fruits of their labor, or the honey of their labor, I guess. Yeah, I could try and work in some good points.
I wrote that down.
Did you really?
I was trying to find a great way to work in honey and fruits of their labor, and it's just like, oh.
Sorry.
It's a sticky situation. Get yourself in. I was not able to.
But anyway, so yes, the bees decide really what they need is good old Max Weber Protestant work ethic, and that's the only thing that keeps the world working, is bees knowing their place as workers. So that's sort of a brief overview, obviously colored a bit with my view on it.
This entire episode, by the way, is full of spoilers for B movie.
If you were
really hoping to see it and haven't seen it since it came out in
2008. DVD release.
Oh, wow.
So not very long, really. Yeah, I'm sure a lot of it's still on your list.
I mean, it is only sold out everywhere.
And I want to address this before we get into the nuts and bolts of this movie. It is a children's movie, and it might seem odd to critique it, But I think it's really valid, and I think it's worth noting because it might be on some people's mind. Because one, like, kids don't necessarily have the faculties to pick up on everything that's every piece of subtext in a movie, but they also don't have the faculties to or the wherewithal to not to have defenses or filters with things. And that's a really good way to start assuming things as you grow up. The lessons you've learned as a kid, you might not even know where they were placed in your head or how you got them. I know it certainly happened to me when I was a kid. And I think it's totally worthwhile. And it gets under the radar being a kid's movie because you feel like, oh, it doesn't matter. But like the kid will see in this movie particularly, they'll think, oh, this is a well-known thing. It wouldn't be in a movie. My parents aren't addressing it. This is like a common thing. It's not even worth thinking about. It's so natural. It's so obvious that if you don't have a job or you get the fruits of your labor, you get the value of your work, you'll do nothing. Like, I think that it's really good to talk about these kinds of things because they're kind of insidious in the way they can sneak up on people.
Yeah. I think you touched on this a little bit, but just to also call out explicitly, the direction that we're taking for this episode is a direction of art criticism, essentially. It might be silly to call a children's movie art, but it is. Actually, I have my own definition of art is very wide. I think this is a huge prediction, but if I could put on my Nostradamus hat, okay. In 1,000 years, I think when archaeologists are discovering our society, they will put in their museums billboards and television commercials and say, this is the art of that era.
Art of manipulation.
Because that's the most prominently displayed. It's the oftentimes the most costly, like Super Bowl ads.
Lots of money goes into it.
Yeah, like these things, I think they will look at and say, oh, this is the art that society valued. Even though we don't often use the word art, that's essentially what it is.
Sure.
And so even a kid's movie is a form of art in a certain way.
Even if you don't, if you want to draw the line and say it's not art, it's certainly a cultural artifact that influences the culture in one way and also reveals things about it. And kids' movies do that constantly. And we spoke to this a little bit, and I guess this is as good a point as any just to jump in. But we were talking about this doesn't have to do with the socioeconomic critique of this movie, but there is a strong racial component here, and we can touch on this and then get into the other stuff. But they're like other species of insects are related to other human races, and we're talking about how that kind of stuff is an easy thing to go for in a kid's movie. It's an easy grab. It's low hanging fruit just to be like, oh, the mosquito is a black guy. Yay. But what it ends up doing is revealing things about the stereotypes that we have in place.
Before we jump into the racism in the movie, because I think that'd be a wonderful place to start, I still want to make a couple of comments just about the concept of art criticism from our take.
Sure.
A couple of things just to tie it straight into Marxism. This is one of my favorite Marx quotes, and I forget where it's from. My own apologies. Maybe we can put it in the show notes. But the quote is, the ideology of any era is the ideology of the ruling class. And so what we're seeing here is we're critiquing art, which is a purveyor of certain ideology. And so when we get into how this movie supports ideas of capitalism, that I think that quote applies. Not just is the ideology of any era the ideology of the ruling class, but there's a relative autonomy to art, which is a phrase I'm stealing from Eugene Hirsch, who's a blogger that I'm reading recently, who blogs all about Marxist art criticism, which is, he's really interesting. Sometime we should do a spiel about him, but Eugene Hirsch, awesome blog. Love your blog, man. And he writes about the relative autonomy of art, saying that there's lots of pieces, there's all these different parts of the base and the superstructure, the economic base being how we organize production, and the superstructure being laws and politics and culture and music and art and all of the rest of it. And Eugene's point is that art is relatively autonomous. So art can be critical or revolutionary, or it can be supportive of the existing economic base. And so the particular choices that are made in this movie have chosen to do one or the other of those things.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess that's just kind of a groundwork that I want to start from as my baseline assumptions for art criticism.
Even though it's a children's movie, they did particularly decide like what to put in it. Even though their innocent joke is still a framework with which you can tell how the creators see this world.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, I have little kids, so I see a lot of kids' stuff. And I would say that children's media is deeply ideological. Mm-hmm. And, like, this movie, a lot of it is, you know, there's obviously ideology painted throughout any work of art, or almost always, especially movies. But children's movies, I think, yeah, because they're playing to kids, so like how you said, Thad, that it's... They don't try and hide it as much. Like they make it a much more accessible for kids. Right.
You know, I think that happens is because they want to construct a simplified version of the world that is, like you said, accessible to a kid. It's digestible for them. It makes sense. But to do that, they end up distilling out the nuances, the complications of the world, and they get right to the core of what they think.
Mm-hmm.
And the things they choose, just like in a documentary, someone might not be writing what the characters say, but they get to decide what goes in that documentary, what things that are said goes in there. So it's very fun to see what nuggets are put into a movie like this.
Yeah.
Because they're supposed to represent the world as a whole. There's a synecdoche thing happening here. These tiny little bits are meant to represent reality for a kid, like opening the door to the wider world. I don't know. Do you guys want to jump into anything
in
particular?
Let's talk about the racism.
Okay.
I feel like we got to start there.
Let me start by pointing out that children's stuff has been just terrible with racism forever. The crows in Dumbo, I mean, that's one just super blatant, racist example.
In the time, though, that was...
Right.
And that was more accepted there, but yeah.
No, but I mean, like, everything. Like, Tom and Jerry... It's always, the houses they're always in is some rich white people's house, and it's a very stereotypical black maid who chases them out if you ever see them engage with a human. Pepe Le Pew, all French men are just rapists, according to them.
For real.
Yeah, no, Pepe Le Pew is disturbing
Dark.
On just so many levels. Not only is it... we won't get into Pepe Le Pew. I'll say one quick thing about Pepe Le Pew. Not only is it saying that all French men are racism.
And smelly.
All French men, are smelly and rapists. But isn't that silly that they like to rape those silly women?
Mm-hmm.
And look at them fight against it, even though it's inevitable.
Yeah. I mean, it totally trivializes it because it's supposed to be a source of comedy. It's a very interesting.
Speedy Gonzalez and all of his cousins who are always the late, you know, they're Speedy
like that.
Speedy Gonzalez, yeah. Well,
I've never been to Mexico. I just assume they're really fast.
Yeah, except for there's one really fast, but he can't speak English. And the ones who can speak English speak it poorly and are always sleepy for some reason. There's a very heavy-handed racism, and that's throughout children's stuff for. Very long time.
And even though we were making fun of how long ago this movie came out when we mentioned the spoilers, this is relatively recent movie. And like Dumbo, I just looked up, was released in 1941. No surprise that there's racism there.
Right.
This was 2008. I was surprised at the amount of racism. Let's talk about some of the examples of it. And the interesting thing is for many of the examples of racism in the movie, I feel like there's not necessarily a real-world correlation.
Mm-hmm.
For example, he threatens to get an ant tattoo. The main character, Barry, threatens his parents with getting an ant tattoo. So ants must be some other race. At least they're some other species, and that would really bother his parents, apparently.
In that same scene, he says maybe he'll start talking like a grasshopper. And he implies that grasshopper has like an urban dialect, and that would infuriate them as well.
Yeah, talking like a grasshopper.
And the overtly Jewish mother stereotype of the mother.
They constantly say, when he starts hanging out with the human, And they don't know that she's a human yet. She asks, is she bee-ish?
Yeah, they say bee-ish a lot.
Yep. And then at one point, they just say Jewish, too. When he's talking to Larry King Bee.
Oh, remember? Yes.
Yeah. He just, that was... So bee-ish, bee-ism and Judaism both exist. Bee-deism. So, yeah, I don't know.
Yeah. the one that I think also struck me as, like, sounding particularly racist was when the guy asked, oh, is your girlfriend a spider? And he says, the main character says, oh, I know that everyone's really into spiders, but I just couldn't get into them because their face is all, eh, is what he says. He says their face is all, eh, which I don't know what that means, but, like, it sounds racist as can be.
It wasn't scary. It was, like, it was definitely, like, an aesthetic judgment. It wasn't, like, yeah. Now, I think this also points out something that I want to say about this movie as we go forward. My next example, because I think some of these examples are muddled because, sometimes they have a clear underlying ideological theme, but it gets counteracted in favor of a crappy joke or simple writing, like easy writing. I think this happens a good amount because there's a part where he meets a mosquito friend. And he's very open to talking with them. It's voiced by Chris Rock. It's very obviously is meant to be a different race. It's kind of established that each species of insect is treated like a different race. They're not supposed to fraternize with anybody, humans, anybody. Like, it's a very, very pure mindset.
Yeah, it's segregationist.
Absolutely. But there's a point where he is daydreaming about dating this human. And they are on a picnic together in a park, and a mosquito lands on her, and she kills the mosquito. And they both look at the carcass of this mosquito for a moment in horror, and then they both laugh, because it actually doesn't matter, because it's not a bee, it's a mosquito. And this is before he meets his mosquito friend. So at that point you think, oh, wait, what? So there's some races it's okay? Like, it doesn't matter? Because it's very well established in this movie that you know, the bees care about being killed. This human that he's with, she cares about certain insects being killed. Like, it matters. The value of life still exists to some extent.
The movie, very early on, with both of these characters, establishes the intrinsic value of life for both humans and bees.
Yeah.
And then mosquitoes, who are just viewed as another race, like they are a sentient being in this world.
And the one representative of them is the maybe one black voice actor in the movie.
Yeah, so, probably.
Yeah. And so it's really well established that, like, he doesn't care. But then later, he obviously, he's not going to be discriminatory or weird about this mosquito. They probably could have written it that way, but they didn't, because it's kind of lazy writing. It's just a one-off joke there. But it does establish that. And another good point is the first time he meets the mosquito, there's a drug and addiction implication. The mosquito is traveling to Alaska to get moose blood because it's like the primo stuff out there. And I don't remember the exact dialogue, but it certainly comes off as a substance abuse issue. Not like he's like bettering himself. Not like it's a nutritional thing. Like, it is a high that he gets. Right.
And not only that, moose blood is what the character is named.
Yeah, I noticed.
So that's just like calling him crackhead. Hey, crackhead! You know,
many. Yep.
Yeah. Like that, you know, I just looked on IMDb. That is the character's name. Is moose blood.
The other thing is that the way that the two species are painted is that bees are really industrious and they work really hard and they're very productive. And, and the mosquito is just like living on the streets, man, and like just looking for his next meal or whatever.
Not only are they productive, they keep the world going, as is shown later. Like, the fruits of their labor are what keeps the world functioning. And these other guys, he even says that it's in service of a bad lawyer joke, but the mosquito says he's already a blood sucking parasite, so it makes sense that he becomes a lawyer.
Yeah.
So
the only African voice, or the only black voice, is a character that identifies as a parasite that has no work ethic whatsoever, just looking to suck blood from other things. And all the bees, which I think are voiced by all white people, as far as I can tell, are industrious, hardworking people that make the world work.
Yeah.
There is one other non-white person voice, and that is Oprah Winfrey is the judge.
Oh yeah, and she was a black woman in the movie.
Yeah, and she was relatively positive.
One of the few humans in New York who is not white in this movie. That's That's something else that needs to be mentioned for racism, is that it was most of the people that were human people that were shown in the movie were white. And the very first non-white character you see is I can't decide what they were going for. I'm guessing Hispanic.
Yeah, but then his accent almost sounded like a cartoonishly Asian.
I don't know. They were going for some sort of... it was supposed to obviously be a not white person. But immediately, this character... I mean, you get other people trying to kill the bees. Other people. But they're just sort of like, I'm scared of bees. Where this character is maliciously just trying to murder the bee. Mm. He is... I'm a killer. I'm going to kill. And then... inexplicably later, they have him be part of a conspiracy and trying to trick Barry as Barry's trying to get to the bottom of where the honey comes from, because he sees him at a grocery store and he's a grocery store worker. So yeah, it's having the very first non-white human you see in the movie is innately violent and evil and conspiratorial and just like... not a good person. You're not. There's no positive aspect to him whatsoever.
The other times that the bee is under threat of being killed, like when a white person tries to kill the bee, it's comical. It's like all this funny stuff happens. It's a comedy of errors. Like they accidentally do this and that. When the person of color tries to kill the bee, like you get the dark music. It's like a real villain, which. It was interesting to me that they decided to make those choices.
Yeah. The saving grace here, though, is we spoke to this before, that there's a general sense in the bee culture of xenophobia. They should not, they don't interact with other species. They definitely don't talk to humans. But the resolution of this movie is definitely that the bees work together with humans. Barry ends up living with a human and having a store together. And we think maybe they have some sort of like loving relationship.
She kicks
movie.
Her husband out.
Yeah.
Halfway through the movie, she kicks her husband out clearly in favor of Barry.
And the last line of the husband is that he says that the bee is living his life. So yeah, there's a strong implication that there's a love story between an insect and a woman. But so that the xenophobia is kind of subverted a little bit. Like, it's shown that we do need to work together. And I'm bringing this up because it's one of the few things that I feel like it actually resolves in a good way. The arc goes towards something progressive. Because as we are going to talk about soon, as we move into the economic parts of these, a lot of the other things go the inverted direction. They kind of start out in a really good trajectory and then switch on you. So yeah, I feel like it does deserve that though. It deserves that little pin, that badge on its sash.
Yeah, we're at the very least, humans and bees found a way to work together.
Yeah, I mean they'll laugh when they kill a mosquito. Whatever, that's probably not going to change. There's not a lot of like inter-animal respect, or at least with the insects. But yeah, there's definitely the way they win in the end is working with the humans, and like the humans they help the plane down. I don't know. I'm not going to get into specifics. No one's going to care, but yes, there is at least that.
So I think we need to talk about the economic aspects of the movie now. And I think it's really interesting. Maybe where we should start is the description of bee society before the conflict is introduced, because that's very interesting.
Yeah.
Bee society is painted as the paramount of efficiency. Mm-hmm. Like, all of the cars can drive at full speed with never running into each other because they're so coordinated, and, like, everything just works. But then there are things like you pick your one job and you have that one job for all of life.
You never have a day off.
Yeah.
Which apparently every other bee loves except for Barry.
Yeah. And they emphasize that it's the only choice you get to make.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, Barry, that's an important thing, is Barry is surrounded by a world of people who have just totally bought into this. It's never really explained why Barry becomes a revolutionary, why he is just born inherently against this when everyone else isn't. And that's fine. It doesn't matter necessarily.
Like it's like he's the one normal person or something.
But it is a cool connection in the sense that because the first half of the movie could very much read like a Marxist supportive script. He is surrounded by a superstructure filled with people who are completely bought in and would never even think of it being anything other than natural to go along with this process.
The interesting thing about it is at the beginning when there's this big push to introduce a conflict, right? The original conflict is Barry not feeling like he fits in with society. That conflict is born mainly out of him having to choose one job for the rest of his life, which I think is supposed to... That's very different from our society today. Nobody ever thinks that they're choosing the one job for the rest of their life, or very rarely is that the case. The trend is recently that we have more and more jobs throughout life.
Right.
And there's, I think there's a big critique that can be leveled against that, like a critique against stable employment and, you know, a company that takes care of its workers and all of that stuff. You know, the less time that you expect to have an employee, the less incentive that company has to take care of that employee to make them a happy employee, blah, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm.
That first bit to paint staying in the same job for all of your life as the worst thing ever, to me, that already is a piece of propaganda, because having one job for all of your life may not be that bad if you like that job. Like, the idea that having multiple jobs throughout your life is intrinsically good, I'm not sure is actually the right answer.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it is if you don't like the job that you're currently at, but that, so... But
yeah.
That already, I think, comes in with, you know, as being interesting in my mind. I'm not saying that my stance is one way or the other, but just we know what our society is, and the movie clearly comes in favor of what our society says.
And there's also part of the reason he wants a job that he can't pick. There's a point where they go up to a board and there's a job, but he wants to be a pollen jockey, which is like the military of the bee world, that goes out and gets the pollen, collects the pollen, and it's not on the board. So he goes and just kind of goes rogue and goes there. But that's all. I want to point that out because there's a very distinct class division, obviously. And it's picking bees. You're going to have to do that unless you're just going to totally ignore that biological aspect of them, is that there's very clear hierarchy in place in the bee world. But I also wanted to point out, like, the bees as a population are the perfect workers. They're, you know, like, they talk about there's 100% employment.
Yeah, which, like, I feel like
that's interesting.
That's an interesting critique right there.
Yeah, but they the way they think is that they're very happy working. They are a work ethic like dream person. They love working. They talk about not having any days off. And there's a point when they're driving at first and their roads are all crazy and loop-de-loopy, and they get there and they're like, whoa, it's like riding a roller coaster. And one guy, I think it's his friend, says that having fun like that is kind of counteracts the fact that they get no vacation. Like, there's a line in there. I don't know if you guys remember that.
Oh, yeah.
But it's these, like, certain minor amusements kind of thrown their way that take place of, like, basic worker rights. Like, these guys should have some time to rest. But they're so for it. Like, they actually... So it's this almost, like, caricature of what you would want the good, exploited working class to be. You want them bought in hook, line, and sinker. And it's real. What's interesting is that gets subverted, but then that gets unsubverted. The subversion in the end of the movie becomes subverted in itself, because it actually folds back and says that is a good way to be.
Yep.
And that's important.
Good way to be. Sorry.
One of the contradictions, too, is they talk about how, in fact, they say that at one point in the movie, what is the quote? You'll just work us to death.
Yep.
And then the like, I don't know, coordinator HR person says, we'll try our best or something like that. And so it's clearly established that the bees seem to not have retirement, like they work until they die. However, both of the main character's parents seem to be retired.
Yeah. I think they do die. Like, at the job board, he talks about a lot of bees dying and opening up jobs, and he's callous about it. He doesn't care.
Mm-hmm.
But I think if you do, it's implied if you reach a certain point, you do get to stop, but it's, you have to be pretty old, and it's very uncommon, and no one gives a crap if you die. It's part of the way these jobs work, that they work you to death.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes sense.
Like the idea of honor dying in battle, it's honor dying in the line of work.
Yeah, well, work is life. Yeah. And when people die, it's a natural process of life, which is a natural process of work. Like, it's just, yeah.
Well, don't they even say, oh, they died while working? Like, oh, death is just life or something like that.
Something like that. They definitely say when they are graduating, and that's a big thing too, academia in this is just training for being part of the workforce. It's immediately during the graduation, their mortar caps fly off and hard helmets fall onto their heads for a production, for a factory. It's very, very overt.
Yeah,
and they say something like, you worked your whole life up to this point so you can work for your whole life. Like, getting through school was so you can get into the workforce and that is your life.
Yeah, it implicitly supports a concept of education that is not about making you an informed citizen, is not about preparing you to participate in a democracy. That
or
is
a
not...
specialized, a highly specialized job. I mean, they get factory cat. Like, you know.
Yep. The dad specifically talks about his job as a stirrer, where you stir and stir and stir, and you get into a groove of just stirring.
Menial tasks.
Yeah. It's I can't remember the exact quote from Marx and the manifesto about, you know, the work of the mechanization, how the work turns down to the most simple, most repetitive operation.
Mm-hmm. So the major conflict of the movie arrives after Barry, our main character, has gone out to the world, spoken with humans, which he's not supposed to do, and that's fine, he falls in love with a human, okay, like, feels a little bit like Romeo and Juliet, like, two star-crossed lovers kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
But it takes a little turn, and the major conflict is the Barry realizes that honey is for sale, and that all of the honey that bees produce is being appropriated by humans, or maybe a lot of it, I guess, because they do use honey in their day-to-day lives. Yeah.
He discovers a bee farm and sees these bees in fake beehives being completely exploited, stolen from, and it infuriates him.
Yeah, the bee farm is like, it is a dystopia right there. Sure. Like, the like beehive with the boxes and the slots that people have and people sedate bees by spraying smoke on them. Mm-hmm. Like, if you're a beekeeper, you spray your beehive with smoke so that bees are, like, chill and don't sting you.
Yeah.
But that's, like, it like, has a strong overtone of, like, a concentration camp almost when he goes there.
Your queen is really a man in drag.
Yeah.
Puppet queen, yeah.
Yeah, their queen was like a fake queen, which I don't even know why they threw that in there.
Maybe it's an actual beekeeping thing where they put... I have no idea. Maybe it's just a bad joke.
I think it's a joke. I don't think there's fake queens when you beekeep. I don't know. We'll find out.
I want to jump one step back because this is also part of the resolution of the movie, but the glorification of the military is something that's not too subtle here. The pollen jockeys are these guys. They're not technically violent, and they are not a war machine, but they are led by someone who's obviously a general. They are outfitted in battle gear, and the thing that they collect pollen with is a gun.
Yeah.
So they're obviously the military.
Yeah, whereas, like, if you actually broke down the analogy, what the pollen jockeys basically are farmers.
Yeah.
Like, that's, like, what it would... That would make the more sense. That would make more sense. Like, they're the people that bring in the raw materials that the rest of the colony lives upon.
Right, and the rest of the colony is a factory, basically. You see the inner workings, and so that's like the factory where they process the food.
Yep.
Not only a factory, sorry.
And I think that's a good analogy, but, like, why are the people that bring in the raw materials the military, unless it's a society that runs off accumulation, primitive accumulation,
but that's
Marx
the key.
Says.
Yeah. They only function by going and getting that pollen. They run off their military industrial complex. That's what they are.
Yeah.
And everyone loves them. Like, culturally, they're really important. They're like celebrities, and Barry wants to be one. And they allow his escape into the world. They allow him to cross the threshold, as it said. Like, and he gets to go out, and, you know, he gets that call to adventure. And in the end of the movie, I'll jump ahead and we can come back, but they are part of the reason that they survive. Like, they're able to militarize and they have a strong organized force that helps them land a plane safely because the humans fly in it and the bees are able to go underneath. So yeah, that's definitely, I think, something Marx would be against. I mean, I know, like, military is not part of socialism, and but I thought that was very striking, and it was less pronounced than other revealing things in the movie, but like it's still there pretty strongly, that this love of the military.
I wonder if the movie, what based on what you just said, now I feel like you could make a case that this movie is a pro-Stalinist movie.
Ooh.
That it's, yep. you sit down, you know your place, you work hard, you choose your one job, and you do the military, and everything will run on time.
Well, it's totally a planned economy is what they're introducing at first, because there's one corporation, it's obviously owned by the state.
Yeah.
Which is also, they mention, is like a conglomerate of a bigger companies, which is kind of weird that they throw that in there. But like when they're talking about how stuff runs, they say, well, what do you mean? Something like, well, everything runs, you know, perfectly. And he says, quote, it all works too well. As if things can work, as if everything runs fine, there's a problem with that.
Yeah.
I feel like they did kind of paint, like, write themselves into a picture, or write themselves into a corner there, because that's a hard place to start from, like, oh, things are too perfect, I need to get away from this society.
Yeah. Were they really, I mean, I guess they talk about the death stuff, but they really don't highlight a lot of actual problems other than dying in the B society.
I have one. And well, it's not perceived as a problem in the movie, but it seems like a problem to me, is that honey is everything. It is it's their food source, it is their cleaning chemical component, it fills swimming pools, it's everything.
Yep.
But it's also what they produce. And I don't know, actually, okay. So my first reaction to this was that a sort of company store mentality where they produce all this honey, but they probably have to buy back a certain amount of it to live.
Uh-huh.
And they probably don't buy it at what they buy it at less than, or at more than what it's worth. So like they can never have.
They do mention honey products being expensive at some point.
And that's the thing. Do they actually say that? Because then I'm thinking, maybe they just get the honey for free.
No, it's like he put on like some hair gel and he's like, fancy. He's like, well, it's a big day. It's worth it.
Mm-hmm. So there's this real company store aspect where they produce the goods, but then they can only buy the goods from the company.
Uh-huh.
And I thought that was pretty crappy. But it's definitely, that was me like searching out for these kind of things. But they definitely try to portray the society as everyone's really happy and everything's perfect.
Yeah.
So I guess we can move on to like the plot more now.
Yep.
So he decides to, they send a letter to the Supreme Court.
Because that's how you file. I actually don't know. Maybe you do, but that's how the bee does it.
You file with a court, I think, but I don't think you can just start with the Supreme Court.
My understanding.
I think it depends on whose jurisdiction it is.
We just need a letter to the Supreme Court, and there you go. You have your day in court.
To sue the human race, because they're obviously exploiting bees. They're giving them nothing, and they're taking everything. But then here's one thing where I think stuff gets a little muddled again, because the bee society is exploitative of bees itself. They have a tiered like hierarchy. It seems that people are in charge.
Yep.
Bees definitely don't get the value of their labor. They don't have the choice in how things are set up. It's very much everything's determined for them.
Yep.
And there must be some power determining that for them. So there's like different levels of exploitation here.
Yes!
And the humans are doing it on a whole other playing field.
Yeah, so there's like bees exploiting other bees, and then humans take a massive cut of that as well.
And that's the problem. That's where it falls short. If the movie had been bees are a perfect communal society where they share everything, all the honey that's made gets provided equally to everybody, and then they find out the humans are exploiting other bees, he sues them, and then I guess you have the weird thing where the world's falling apart because no one wants to work. But even then, if it came back to the bees have to work, but none of them are being exploited anymore. In the end of the movie, the resolution is all the bees in the world, even the ones that were in these concentration camp bee farms, they're now all part of communal societies. They're all now communists and they get to be that way.
Uh-huh.
That'd be great. But what they fall back on, the resolution is they fall back on their original tiny petite capitalism that, you know, like their tiny little beehive of exploitation. And so in the end, like that is, the message is not that what the humans were doing was bad. The message is just that the way the humans were doing it, I guess, was kind of bad.
Yeah.
Or
the movie makes this really bizarre assumption that once all of the bees don't, once all of the bees get to keep their honey, that yes. every bee stops working right. just right then and there.
So that's what happened. Tony said this before. They win the lawsuit. They get all the honey back as restitution from all the store cells.
Which, did anybody pick up on that part? Barry starts out, you know, sort of the confused, lost bee. Then he finds out about this problem. Then it becomes Barry takes on the role of a revolutionary.
Yep.
And then, as soon as the revolution comes to fruition, he's demanding things of humans. He's taking things from them by force. It seems sort of like they're trying to invoke, like a almost not quite the terror, but, you know, something like that. Mm. And then showing how everything goes south of that, it really, to me, seemed like they were trying to throw in, like, a, you know, the arc of the French Revolution sort Ooh. Of thing in there. I thought they were trying to impose yeah. on it.
So that's what happens. They get all their honey back, so all their coffers fill in these beehives, and then they're like, shut down production. Then what you see is every bee lays down by the pool like they're going on vacation, right? And these are society that hated the idea of vacation. They never wanted it. Now they're suddenly doing it.
Yeah.
And all you see eventually, I think the best example is at some point you see Barry's friend who, because he does not have a job in his life, he is laying backwards on a couch over the back with his head hanging back, and he's squirting, I guess, honey whiz. It looks like cheese whiz into his yep. mouth and watching TV. And this was one of the most industrious, brainwashed bees around Barry. It, yep. In Barry the Revolutionary, like that period of the movie, he has to convince his friend to come out, like, to be, like, that's part of his revolution too, is having to convince everyone around him to do it. But then even this guy, he immediately, when he doesn't have to work, no point to life. No incentive to do anything.
Yep. Not only that, but to really drive home how ridiculous this point in the movie is, I think, mm-hmm. is saying, okay, let's assume that the humans were taking, I don't know, 50% of the honey. So the bees had 50%, the humans had 50%. Now that the lawsuit goes through, humans don't get any honey, the bees get all the honey. So there's two possible options. The bees work equally as hard as before because they're used to it and they don't mind it, which the movie completely set up, and they all get twice as much honey.
Mm-hmm.
That's a possibility.
Sounds awesome.
Or all of the bees say, the amount of honey we have is fine. Let's all take every other day off or whatever. Have some vacation days because they talk about or have a retirement at the end of life. Have a bunch of leisure time that we never had before, which probably they wouldn't go for based on what they've set up, but would be a logical step.
Yeah, it's lazy writing.
Instead, what the movie suggests is that they will stop entirely.
Yeah.
It would be like if you got a 100% raise, so your boss came to you and said, guess what, we're paying you double now. Might make sense for you to work half-time so that you have a lot more leisure time or time to do other things and still make the same amount of money. Or you might just want to make twice as much money. That mm-hmm. would be fine, too. But you probably would not turn around and say, thank you, I quit.
Yep.
That's the assumption that this movie makes about an entire society.
Yeah.
That's what they would do.
And it goes out of its way to do that because it's set up that the bees are not against capitalism. They're fine. Like, when Barry first encounters a shop, he's not, like, bewildered by the concept of that. But there's no moment where any bees say, look at all this surplus of honey. Let's start selling it back to the humans. They like it. Maybe we can get stuff from them. I guess maybe you could say the bees don't care about anything but honey. Whatever. I don't know. But it seems like, yes, like you said, it's most logical that they would want to keep working because it's been set up. It makes a lot of sense that now that they have all this this windfall of honey, maybe they do something with it. But yeah, it's going out of its way to be like, oh, humans are inherently lazy, by the way. Hey, kids, if you don't have a job, you're going to do nothing and nothing and nothing.
It's I think, a standard movie trope to propose, to set up a revolutionary that wants to stir things up, and that the revolution always gets corrupted or fails in some way, or if it succeeds, turns out it was a grass is always greener situation where it's not as good as you thought. But this movie really bends over backwards to try to make the outcome bad when I don't think it can logically justify it. It justifies it in a completely illogical way.
Well, I think it's just them doing the same old, well, the USSR failed due to laziness trope.
Yeah.
That we've talked about before.
Usually when you have that structure where someone, the hero, wants to do something really interesting, he goes on the limb and takes a risk and realizes by his own arrogance or hubris, he did the wrong thing. Oh, I made this mistake. I thought it would be for the best, but now I have to go back and fix things. Like usually it's sort of at the source of his own arrogance or something, someone that misled him. But in this, it's saying that what misled him is the idea of just human nature. He was too idealistic to think that humans are nothing but lazy sacks of crap that just need capitalism to get them up in the morning.
The thing that I would like to also bring up is that the relation between bees working and humans appropriating that honey is not necessarily set up, it's not defined well. So, Are the bees slaves to the humans? Are the bees employed by the humans for a wage? You know, what is the relation of production between them? So far, it seems like it's probably closest to slavery. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But let's assume that it is. Then what the message of the movie is that slavery is good. Because if you freed the slaves, they would just stop working and everything would fall apart. I mean, as far as I can tell, this is a pro-slavery movie. That's going to sound extreme, but I don't think there's anything in... Like, if you look at what actually happens in the movie, I think that's true.
The bees that are in the bee farm certainly seem like slaves to me. But the bees that are free in their society, they seem more like wage slaves to me. And I see where you're coming from, and I totally, you can read it that way, but you can also read it that slavery is wrong, yeah, we all agree on that, but capitalism, yeah, that wins. So even if you go farther than what you're saying, and the slavery is the bad thing, then the capitalism, which was, you know, we went away from a slavery-based economy here in the United States, and then capitalism competed with that and won, in many ways. I mean, I don't know. That's an oversimplification. But I think there is a way that it is saying that as well. Mm-hmm. But you're right. Like, it is, the implications here are far-reaching and, numerous, but they're all nefarious. They're, like, dark.
Well, and I think, too, especially with the dark implications, when they're talking about the ecological disaster, they literally say the world is going to end.
Yeah.
And it's not, the world is not going to end through ecological, or it's going to end through ecological disaster, but not because of capitalism. It's because of socialism that will destroy the world, and only capitalism can keep our world alive and our environment healthy.
Yep, nothing's getting done anymore. And that exploitation was helping, and so we need to go back to that. There's a great quote, by the way, from the one human says at some point, they just says, they make the honey, we make the money. It's a perfect capitalist motto.
I also love that that's a beekeeper, like, just like a rank and file worker that says that. It doesn't make any sense, but like, I guess it would have been awkward for the movie to like pan to a guy sitting behind a glass screen smoking a cigar
bored.
Who said that.
Yeah. Well, they need to make him a villain, but it's so funny that it's probably this like minimum wage worker who is like high on power because he controls bees. Like, yeah, they make the honey, we make the money.
Speaking of good quotes, another one that I saw was, this is at the moment of the revelation of exploitation, when Barry realizes that bee's honey is being appropriated by humans and sold on the market. He says that the honey is everything we have, everything we are, which I think is really interesting. I think it ties back into Marx's writings on alienation in the Economic and Philosophic Manuscripts, where, humans are for a large part defined by the fact that we can think and plan our own labor and then carry it out. And so we are defined by the labor that we do. That's who we become. That fits right into the Barry referring to all of their honey as everything we have, everything we are.
Yeah. Another good quote. is once Barry realizes that everything is going south after his successful revolution, he says, "Had to open my mouth and talk." So he's lamenting the fact that he ever stood up for the bees, or, you know, the workers in this case, and that he ever tried to make a better, more equitable society, that is, you know, always the wrong thing to do, is opening your mouth and to speak against the system.
Mm-hmm.
The end of the movie, where everything is okay again, the bees start pollinating again, so the bees are working again. However, it is completely unclear what the relation between bees and humans is.
Yeah.
In other words, do the bees now have rights and they negotiate with the humans over the price of honey? If that's the case at the end, I'm not sure why that didn't just happen at the beginning. But it's the movie kind of leaves it open at the end. All we know is that the bees start working again.
Yeah, my reading of it, or what it seemed to be, is Barry and his friend, and the mosquito comes back randomly,
to be a lawyer.
Are all lawyers suddenly, and Barry is with the woman. So they're the only bugs you see with any sort of different role. Otherwise, they sort of make the implication that everybody gets really excited when they're going to go back to work. I guess at the climax of the movie? I don't know. It seemed kind of anticlimactic, so it's kind of hard to pick it out. But, you know, all the bees were excited to go back to work, so I guess my impression was that they were just going to go back to the way everything was. But yeah, they don't explain. They don't. The only thing you see concretely is what happens with Barry and his friends.
Yeah. Barry becomes a lawyer and is consulting a cow at the end of the movie about the cow's kind of labor disputes. So, like, to me, it seems like maybe what's happened is they've developed a certain degree of workers' rights. Like, they've developed labor laws, and that's as far as the movie is willing to go. So it's like, okay, you still need to produce a surplus for this ruling class, but
if that cow then got all her milk and cheese, she would do nothing.
Yeah, you can't have the cow get all of their product. That would be awful. That would be the downfall of society. But maybe we could treat them a little bit better.
Yeah. Right. So basically the National Labor Relations Board, the sort of, okay, well, we'll make a few concessions to workers, but really confine them in a box so that they can't really do too much to the system.
That's right. And I think that from the very beginning, the movie is very, like, legalistic in its framework.
Oh, yeah.
Because they're, like, the bees don't go on strike or anything like that. They file a lawsuit and they sue to get the rights to their honey.
That's kind of interesting that there's not a cultural movement for the bees that you see. Barry has to convince the people around him. He gets his friend on board, which is a big part of it. And they're like, "What can one bee do?" And they're like, "Well, we'll do a lawsuit." Which eventually the point is what one bee can do is, nothing, because he shouldn't have done it anyway, and goes back on himself. But the bees show up right in the courthouse. It's full of bees, but none of them voice anything. None of them hoot and holler. They're not supportive. They don't have signs.
Yep.
They're passive viewers of what's going on. They take what happens, the windfall. And so they're like this malleable mass that's not really, has no voice. They're represented by one guy, basically, and it super simplifies, like, nobody gets a fair voice in anything, even when Barry's revolting. Like, it's just kind of like, okay, we'll go along with what he says, and then when things change again, okay, we'll go back to the way things were.
It's the great man of history trope.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Yep. I love the fact that you point out that there's, like, no activism, there's no movement building, like, anything where large groups of sentient beings...
The common man means nothing.
Yeah, when people, or in this case bees, I guess, gain rights, that's never won through just simply a legal battle. There's always a massive, you know, conscious building movement and activism and you know, the knocking doors and handing out flyers and talking to people. There's just tons of that stuff that goes into any political battle, and that was all erased from this movie. And none of that happened.
You couldn't have it in the movie in a way, because since they kind of go back on their message and turn it around on itself, if you had all these people throughout the movie that were supporting it, invested in it, passionate, and then you can't have your tidy little cleanup where everything goes back to the exploitive way it was, because all these people will be devastated.
Yeah.
You have to have them sort of mindless and just this current that goes wherever it's pointed. Mm-hmm. So that you can bring them back. They don't care.
Yep.
They don't care. People are just waiting for what's best for them to be given to them. And they're given it.
I was also wondering with the beehives and sort of the puppet leader, if maybe not slavery, but colonialism. If that was supposed to represent colonialism, you know, with the sort of installed foreign leader thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it is a queen. Like, obviously that's a bee thing, but like it's very clearly they said that it's a queen. It is a monarchy in place.
Drag queen, yeah, as they stupidly said.
Although, at one point in the movie, they point out that they elect their queen. Would you, have you shown this movie to your kid?
No. God, no. he's not seen this movie unless he happens to notice it. Like, as soon as I got it from the library, like, I immediately hid it away in my bag so he would not want to watch it.
Yeah, show
because
it to him,
I
like
really think this is just a horrible messaging for movies. Yeah. I mean, like I said, most children's movies are ideological, and like some of them can be really terrible. Like we watched The Box Trolls recently, which was pretty cute. The overall message about that was mostly you were born a certain way and into a certain class, and that is the only right way is to stay in that. So, like even that, you know. It was really cute and touching at parts, but it was also horrifying.
That's tough, too, because I think I've grown up seeing things like that, and it doesn't necessarily direct the way you think, but it can't, you can't help but have it inform the way you think.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you have no idea how deep that's going to be, how long-lasting, or in what way it's going to affect them. And so, yeah, it's got to be tough being a parent, like deciding what they're exposed to. Because at a certain point, they're just going to be exposed to anything. They're going to be out there. But you want to give them a foundation of, like, I want to shield them from these things until they have the tools to pull it apart, to see it for what it's worth and make their own choices. And again, like, pulling around, kind of bookending it, that's the key thing about a kid's movie, too, is, like, it is directed at people that don't have necessarily the expertise to deal with the things that are given to them. So it should be really, really important to look at these. But anything. I mean, this happens in adult movies too, where people don't want to think about the implications. And in fact, there's an argument to be made that once you're an adult, like, who cares about the underlying xenophobia in the movie 300? It's just a fun, like, violent schlock fest. But it kind of matters if you don't think about it sometimes. It kind of gets to you.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's worth remembering so that we do talk about it. It's the things affect you more when you're unaware of them, you know?
I think the Cracked podcast makes a good point that we pull in so much of our information from pop culture.
Totally.
So, like, you know, all of us have an image of Moscow in our minds, but, you know, we don't know.
Yeah.
We don't know what Moscow's like, but if you asked me, I could tell you, well, there's Red Square, and there's the Kremlin, and that's where they put Lenin's body on display occasionally. And
yeah, I'm like, how much of that
and it's always winter
from TV and movies? Yeah, it's like everything almost.
Yeah, so even though, yeah, we have the apparatus, the cognitive tools to analyze and process things like that, there's still, if that's the only thing we get, you know, it's kind of hard to put it all in proper context.
Yeah, it's important to be skeptical, and it's important to constantly be curious about where these messages are coming from and what they really mean to you. Like, no matter what it is, whether like an ad, we don't really think about those as cultural artifacts or affecting us, but that's all they're designed to do.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's good to be aware, and it's good to think about these. I'm really glad that you wanted to do this about a movie, and a kid's movie in particular. It's really fun for me.
Good.
So thank you.
Yeah, I'm glad it worked out well.
All right, good. That's the end.
Yay. This episode is part of the Marxism Today podcast series.
Marxism Today is recorded, mixed, edited, produced, and maintained by Tony Schmidt and Red Wagner. It is distributed freely and licensed under the Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial Sharealike 3.0 license. To find out more about the Marxism Today podcast, visit our website at marxismtodaypodcast.wordpress.com, where you can find archives of all of our episodes available for download. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next time.